I'm going to let you hold forth on what it means for the United States to suspend the shipment of JDAMs. You got to explain what they are, why they are important, and what it will do to the Israeli offensive in Rafah, please.
A Joint Direct Action Munition, JDAM is the acronym. It's a very accurate form of air-dropped weapon that can be used with extreme precision. So it is the weapon that Israel will need if it's going to do what it has set out to do, which is to conduct using their spokesman's word, a precision counterterrorism operation. So if they don't have the JDAMs to conduct that operation, they will use other weapons that will cause higher levels of collateral damage. So a JDAM is the weapon that Israel needs to conduct this operation in as safe a manner as it can be conducted.
Now, you tend to avoid criticism of both Republicans and Democrats, but I, for the life of me, can't understand this, because I knew what a JDAM was, and I think Israel will have to turn to less precise munitions, artillery shells or dumber bombs. And I'm curious, why in the world would an administration take away that which limits civilian casualties the most?
I don't have a ready answer for that. I would be guessing. I will tell you this. We need to continue to support Israel. And frankly, it's not just with precision-guided JDAMs. We have to support them with cyber, with intelligence, with the mechanisms they need to decommission this complex of tunnels that are beneath Gaza, which include high-end engineering, precisely available explosives. All of that needs to be part of a package of support to Israel. And I continue to believe that supporting Israel in this conflict with a terrorist organization, I mean, let's step back here. This is a terrorist group that has raped and mutilated and killed, is using their own people as human shields. We ought to be giving Israel full support in this moment.
Now, Admiral, I want to turn to a different subject, which has to do with conducting diplomacy. You've done a lot of that, and I want people to understand, as Allied Supreme Commander of NATO, he had to do a lot of it. Apparently, according to Axios this morning, the United States and Egypt negotiated a deal with Hamas that Israel rejected, and they didn't get Israel's input before they announced that a deal was there. That's unprecedented in my view. Is it unprecedented in your view?
It is, and I was not only the Supreme Allied Commander of NATO, but I spent 5 years as the Dean of the Wait for it, Fletcher School of Law and Diplomacy. It's a school of diplomacy, and I'm hard-pressed to recall another instance in a significant war-fighting negotiation where one party decides to change the terms and then announce that we have a deal. Let's be very clear here. The deal that Hamas has come back with is completely unacceptable. It fails in both space and time. What I mean by that is the space is that the Hamas says Israel has to simply leave Gaza. That's impossible. And then secondly, the Hamas version says that this is the end of the war, the time element here, that the war is concluded. The point being that if those two things occurred, this reprehensible leader of Hamas, Sinwar, would emerge from the tunnels, blinking at the light of the sun above him, and announce that Hamas won the war. That's impossible for Israel to accept. The way this concluding part of the negotiation unfolded, diplomatically unacceptable.
Now, Admiral, I want to turn to the Rockefeller Foundation, and I don't want to put you on the spot, so I'll tell you the whole story and then just see if you want to comment or not. You probably don't know anything about this. There are allegations that the Rockefeller Fund, which is not the Rockefeller Foundation until
correct,
someone tells me that it is, has been funding an organization that is in turn supporting campus protests that are blatantly anti-Semitic. Any idea what that is? Is that on your radar at all?
It is not, other than a number of friends have sent exactly what you just said to me, and I will reply in the way I did and will continue to do, which is John D. Rockefeller, the richest man in the world over 100 years ago, endowed a host of different things around the country to which he put his name, one of which is the Rockefeller Fund. We have nothing to do with it.
Ah.
It would be like if the name was Smith. I mean, it's a very common name. The Rockefeller Fund has its own source of funding, its own uses. I know nothing about the Rockefeller Fund. There's also, for example, a Rockefeller University. We have nothing to do with Rockefeller University. There are buildings all around the country and libraries that are named after Rockefeller. We have nothing to do with
There's a Rockefeller rest stop on the 90. You got nothing to do with that either?
Nope, nothing to do with that one either, Hugh.
Admiral, okay, so I gotta now switch one more time. Sure. Congressman Michael Waltz, who's on Armed Services, Foreign Affairs, and Intel, has replaced the now retired Mike Gallagher as my David Dreyer Honorary House Member of the Week. He tells me there's a naval strategy coming out of Congress this week. What does that matter to the Navy? Do they even care? Does anyone read these things?
I think people read them, and having worked in a strategy in the Pentagon for many, many years, like our mutual friend, Jerry Hendricks, you know, it's all input, and people have ideas, and they're thoughtful sometimes, and it goes grist into the mill. I doubt a congressional naval strategy will be at the center of the Navy's thinking, but I'll make a point here. Many in Congress, and I would count Mike Waltz, who, as you know, is a Green Beret, Special Forces, Colonel, I believe, in the reserves, well thought of on the defense side of things. I'm sure that naval strategy, if his fingerprints are on it, will talk about the need for a fleet that is of significant size to stand up to China. And I for one, will read the strategy. If it's good and it talks about increasing the size of the U.S. Navy, I bet it will. I will get behind it and talk about it and recommend it to the Navy staff, the Joint Chiefs, and the Pentagon.
Last question, Admiral. I want to give you 2 or 3 minutes to expound on this. Joe Lonsdale, venture capitalist and co-founder of Palantir, was on the show last week. Not to talk about Palantir, but about a couple of his other startups, which have ambition to become a so-called prime and to deliver submersibles to the Navy. What do you, because they think the future is submersibles and Joe gets stuff done. What are the odds of that actually happening, do you think?
I think they are pretty good for 2 reasons. One is spot on that the future of naval warfare is under the sea. The real predators of the ocean, apex predators, are nuclear attack submarines. These have very small crews, 100-ish or so. They can remain submerged indefinitely, limited only by food for the crew, and they have lethal torpedo systems that can sink surface ships. They're quite remarkable, and you can attack them from the air, you can attack them from destroyers, but boy, I wouldn't like those odds, being a destroyer captain again, going up against a nuclear attack submarine. So point one, he's on to a real demand signal. And point two, frankly, where he will head no doubt is unmanned or very small crews. And that, I think, is also the future of warfare generally, but it also reduces cost. It can be done much more quickly. A Palantir-like set of solutions applied to these big, complex challenges, I think, is very attractive. Final thought, it's like what we're watching in Ukraine, where we're seeing drones, smaller, quicker, lighter, yet more lethal, knitted together by artificial intelligence. Think that kind of drone swarm applied to the ocean, below the ocean. That's a pretty powerful thought. I wouldn't bet against him.
All right, okay, bonus question, Admiral. His other company doing directed energy research and weaponry, and I chatted last night with someone about they're basically lasers. Do you think we're close on that?
I do, and I've been following this issue for a decade, and think about it this way. The way we knock down incoming missiles today, and think of them as like a telephone pole flying through the air, we launch another telephone pole that goes up into the air and seeks to find that precise point and knock it down. unbelievably, we are pretty good at doing that. But the problem is you run out of telephone poles pretty quickly. With directed energy lasers, you have an unlimited supply. So you can shoot again and again and again, and your odds of knocking down those incoming telephone poles are extremely high. And yes, we're getting closer and closer. Both Air Force is very involved, Navy very involved. These will be on ships. The Iron Dome system has a guided laser system coming right behind it. I think, not to make a bad pun here, but the future is bright for those lasers.
Oh, Admiral, that is pretty bad.